My name is Nat Trotman. I'm curator of performance and media here at the museum, and together with Christina Yang and Anna Harshanyi, co-organized both Shaun's project and the Circle Through New York project prior. That was the prior phase of our social practice initiative. First off, because I think I wouldn't be allowed up here in this if I didn't thank numerous people before getting into anything else. Thank you to all of you. Thank you, Lisa, especially for that incredible, deeply researched presentation. And thank you too to Greg, Jackie, Pepon, and our Primitive Games partners for being here. And thank you to all of you who are still here after 2 hours and 45 minutes. Holding out for the reception and the book sale, which I know you're all super excited about upstairs. we're running a little behind time, so I do have a few things that I've written down during the course of the talks, but I kind of feel like you did my job for me by ending your talk in this like huge rundown of questions. So yeah. Just before I launch anything, I just wanted to ask if you guys have anything you want to ask each other, or if especially Elizabeth or Shaun might have anything you want to ask Lisa, or any responses you'd like to make to this talk, which I'm sure you're still processing to a certain extent. And if not, that's fine.
I mean, I think it echoes from the perspective of an arts administrator. At least this is what I've heard in it, you tell me. Some of what we were hearing from Pepon and Jackie and Brett, where they're saying, look, you know, it's this system that is not transparent, right? Mm. And where anyone who is not inside of it, and even some of those who are, can feel quite disempowered. Even if you understand the mechanisms by which, you know, it works, it's sometimes difficult to navigate that. Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, it's a challenge. It's a strange, strange system.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, it results in more questions, as you can imagine. But I, as an artist that worked in cultural institutions for 15 years, I have often asked myself, what is the role? Is it a responsibility of an artist to engage with the board? Mm-hmm. And is there a space where that can be done with responsibility in that some of that power is handed over to the artist in any way? Because it seems to me, in negotiating that power, that it's always on not the artist's terms. Mm-hmm. And so I continue to ask myself that question, like, so how can it be done? And I often land on that it's not the responsibility of the artist, that actually institutions need to be accountable and responsible in recreating themselves. And of course, that brings up all sorts of issues in terms of like how hierarchical institutions are. And so where I often try to fit in is finding the time and place where I might be able to be a catalyst in even the most deceptive ways of helping an institution recreate itself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that brings to mind something that you had said in your panel earlier at the close that really struck me, talking about the way that values sort of become these belief systems and get codified in a way that becomes exclusionary, and how similar that is to some of the ways that institutions work.
Sure.
And how sort of contra to Brett a little bit, I guess. I mean, obviously institutions are collections of individuals, and there are ways that individuals like curators within museums can become vulnerable in the act of a process of putting together a project. But that vulnerability doesn't necessarily translate into institutional vulnerability.
Right.
And how do we envision a form of institutional vulnerability that can be productive to bring about some of these forms of change that obviously need to happen? And it's certainly not something I have an answer to. I don't expect any of you to. But from everything you've said, it feels like transparency is one of a primary form mm-hmm. of vulnerability. Mm-hmm. But I'm curious if you have further thoughts about that.
I mean, I do think that, I mean,
I've been
at this for, I don't know, a long time.
Yeah, it's not an accident.
Let's just say decades.
It's not an accident that you all work in institutions and that you're
exactly,
all here on stage.
Right.
Have
and
worked.
I,
yeah.
You know, I do think you know it's unquestionable that there's much greater permeability in the walls of the institutions in sort of every imaginable way than there once was. And the fact that we're having this conversation in this place is evidence of that, which is not in any way to say that there isn't more work to be done, but at least people are not pretending there's not an issue, you know? So that's, you know, like the first, you know, the first thing you do is you recognize, you know, what's wrong and then you try to fix it, right? And I think that the work that all of the artists that we've heard from today, and indeed all of the administrators that we've heard from today, reflects a strong desire to try to rethink and reimagine that. And I think that there are a number of questions that I have about how that functions within a system where this, you know, the board of directors, the ED, the way that these institutions are, ED's executive director, where these things are structured in such a way because of the way that it works within the tax code, because of the way that it works within certain kind of legalistic structures and systems. And so part of the issue is in the way that these things have been conceived in the first place. And this speaks, I think, to your point, Lisa, that this is rooted in a 19th century system, which was absolutely part and parcel of industrialization and colonialism. Yeah. And so how do we tear that apart in a way that doesn't damage institutions that are doing good work, but that allows for the possibility to rebuild a structure in the image of what we want to envision, mm-hmm. right? Not in the sense of let's fix what's broken. I mean, great if you can do a little of that, but really like crack it open, imagine the future, like, you know, envision something alternate in a very real way.
So I suspect, I mean, I don't know you that well, Shaun, but last night somebody said, I was mentioning how many people were here and how I knew everyone, and somebody said, well, yeah, Shaun, brings people out. Like, you're a people person, you want to talk to people when something's going on, right? I assume, and that's been my experience of you. As opposed to me, I tend to be an introvert. So I'm really interested in the way that you're thinking around engaging with the institution or the board means meant for you that you needed to go speak to the board, you needed to perhaps do a lot more in terms of engaging or being at meetings or do something else. When maybe I didn't convey it well enough, I think what I'm offering as something else that can be done is to really look at the paperwork, understand, like, in the same way that you might or probably should just at least know who your city council person is, mm-hmm. just know who your state senator is. Those are the conversations I'm talking about with artists when I'm surprised that they don't know those things.
Sure.
But I think that those things are not transparent. And like, why don't we have some kind of page about board members that really explicitly explains what they believe in and what they vote on and, you know, what they do in the way that we do for the other public servants in our life? And somehow our cultural institutions have been able to get away with not doing that. And can we think about you know, so many people I know don't realize that you can see the financials on websites. It's public information. So, you know, you should have some sense about some of the resources. Now, frankly, with large institutions, they're more complicated, and they involve, you know, tax codes and what's it called, depreciation, and all these things that are hard to parse out. But it's a starting point. It's kind of getting a sense of where you are. But I also think it can start on a smaller level of when you're engaging an artist into the practice to really go over budgets and see things, you know, and have those conversations. But really, first and foremost, it's sort of like, well, do you know the people in the development department? Do you even know what a development department is? Do you know, I happen to just have the experience of working in the registrar department at a museum very early on, so that really helped me understand an institution in a way that I realized people with PhDs didn't understand in art history, right? Because in the registrar department, for those who know, they manage the collection, they're paying for the insurance, they are checking the collection, they are, they really are responsible for articulating the value of every single object in the collection and then how we're gonna care for it. And that's kind of my long answer to
that. That's great. Yeah. It's almost 7, so I would like to hear some questions from the audience. There are two microphones at the front of the two aisles, so please use those. Hi.
Does this work? Mm-hmm. Well, thank you all. This was really terrific and very provocative, and I have many, many, many questions. But overall, what I heard was strategies to include demographics that haven't been included, and the primary strategy that I heard proposed was transparency. And my question is, in the age of this administration, how dangerous is that for artists, for institutions, for curators? My sense is that it's getting imminently more dangerous. But adaptation is evolution.
I mean, in my experience, to be a curator or an artist is to have a public face, and your job is to be engaging with the public in a way that is as transparent as possible. I'm not saying everybody practices in that way, but that's sort of like the aim, I think, in a lot of ways, at least of many of the colleagues that I have these conversations with. So I don't think that's so scary. Because usually our politics are pretty apparent in the work that we're doing. And so we're kind of already out there if anybody bothers to think about it. And we're not too quiet about it. I think it's a lot scarier for the board because a lot of them are specifically interested in participating in a kind of cultural power that veils some of the other things that they do. And that's not to say that everyone is in that boat, because they're not. There are many wonderful, caring, generous people on boards who are doing terrific work and are very dedicated. But there's a reason that there are tons of protests about the Koch brothers, donating to the Natural History Museum, whatever, things like that, right? Again, stuff that they're being outed by the artists. If we did have a mechanism of transparency like the one that you suggest, Lisa, I think that would be real different real fast. Mm-hmm. It might also mean that the entire structure of the way these things are budgeted changed. It could really contribute to that kind of systemic alteration in the mechanism of nonprofit administration, i.e. having a board with specific legal fiduciary duties, et cetera, that might have to transform. And it would be interesting to see what happened.
Yeah, I got a lot to say about this. I'm going to try to be succinct. This is a very particular conversation that occurred around the consortium of museums that proposed to pose the institution as sanctuary when sanctuary cities were at risk. And that would require museums position themselves transparently in terms of their politics, in aligning with marginal populations that would be directly at risk. And of course, the next very concern was like, okay, if we're welcoming these communities into our doors, are we then enunciating the threat? We're essentially labeling those individuals simply by saying, we're a sanctuary, we will welcome you in. So that transparency, to your point, all of a sudden brings a risk. So what I'm going to say to you is that no, transparency is not enough. when you open that door and start to enunciate exactly what your politics are, how are you going to own that? Mm-hmm. It is not enough to bring someone into a building and not allow that to then rupture from whether it's from the down up, whatever it might be. I won't name where I've worked because this is a document. You can find it, it's easy. But, you know, there were instances in my professional life, and I've always approached my careers within museum as an artist, you know, that I've brought in homeless men and women, LGBTQ youth, formerly incarcerated individuals, the list goes on and on, into a museum. Now, to have 60 homeless men navigate the museum requires that the entire museum rethink the way it operates. That has to be owned from security all the way up. That posed a lot of risk and a shit ton of labor on me, unfortunately, because there's always going to be resistance and shift in cultural change, in owning beyond transparency. And yet, I still think there's value there. I no longer work for that institution, so that says something. But yet, I will still continue to figure out ways to create that little bit of rupture. Right.
You start because I worked in a museum for 14 years.
I'm not going to tell your story.
It's also easily Google. I just want to ask about duration. I'm going to take a different direction a little bit because one of the challenges that I faced as, you know, someone commissioning and collaborating with artists in community spaces is the project isn't done, right? And is it the responsibility of the institution to think about how it continues and what responsibility it has for opening up that relationship, or is it the artists or both, and how, as this practice enters a museum, and who's nurturing that within the museum, or who's responsible for that or accountable for that within the museum? Is it the education department? Is it the curator? Is it who's responsible for that? And are we thinking about that as we start doing social practice that's not just time-bound and like, here's the end, here's the performance or the event, and it's the end. Like, if you're doing relational work with communities outside the museum walls, like, what does that mean, and how have you dealt with that?
Do you want us all to answer that?
Anyone?
Yeah, it sounded like it was to me. I think it's important to acknowledge that the performance is, while it's the most spectacular piece, for me, it's just one very small piece. I also want to make it clear that my negotiation with any institution, whether it be the NYPD or the Guggenheim Museum, is not a compromise, it's the work. I find that to be very much part of the process. All the code switching, all the meetings, and the ways in which I ask institutions to meet me halfway is the work. Much of that goes invisible. I'm okay with that. Other than the board, actually, I think I've met with every department here in this process, 4 months. I asked to be part of the evaluation process. And this is going to your point, Lisa. I asked to see the entire budget. I asked to meet with security. I asked to hear in the institutional language, what are the anxieties around social practice? And not only hosting it, but owning it. I think it's incredibly important for an artist that works, that really wants to think of themselves as a social practitioner, to invade as many areas that are supposed to be supporting and nurturing the work, to really have a relationship. So the institutional relationship is also ongoing, I would say. But also my relationship to all of to the four groups that were part of this project started well before the Guggenheim and will last well after. And that's what excites me, you know?
Yeah. I mean, in terms of the way that a museum is taking that on, and or a nonprofit, an arts institution, let's say, you know, I think that you can't if you're going to do a lot of engaged work, you cannot simply keep stacking up the projects of unlimited duration, because that's the way for you to find really quick staff turnover and lots of people like crying with exhaustion under their desk. And so there has to be a sense of how the sustainability is handled and distributed across different areas of responsibility. And I think that for the institution, whatever sort it might be, there has to be a real intentionality about choosing what communities they want to engage with and why. If you are engaging with your immediate geographic area, or if you're engaging with a community that has special meaning to you, it needs to be part of the vision of the institution to do so. It needs to be something that curators and educators and outreach people, engagement specialists, whatever they're being called a lot of different things all of a sudden in the last 5 years, they need to understand that as part of the vision of the institution. They need to internalize that. Like you say, they need to own it. And then there needs to be agreement and intentionality about how they're going out and engaging in a responsible, involved, and absolutely engaged long-term way with those communities. And so when they're commissioning artists to work with them and do social practice, it has to be something that aligns. And that push-pull between the needs of the institution and the need of the artistic vision has to be sort of a copacetic dance that happens. It's a negotiation. And as you say, the process is the product, right? What you are doing in that negotiation process is what's opening the institution up, is what's helping the people within it to rearrange their roles and responsibilities and job titles a little bit so that they are able to create the kind of flexibility that I think we all hope to see within these kinds of institutions. I've spoken too much, sorry.
That's great, thank you. Your turn, if you want.
I want to make sure that you had a chance to respond to Prerna if you wanted to, Lisa.
No, I'm okay.
Okay. Thank you. I've been working in community performance and activism for 20 years, and this is the first time I have ever heard a conversation like this within the confines of a museum. I'm trying not to cry right now. I want to have a 30-minute conversation with each of you tonight. And I know that's not possible, but I'm very excited about the possibilities of just knowing that you all are existing in the world and doing this work. And so I have so many questions. I feel like all my neurons are exploding in my brain. There's so many things that have been touched on about artists' process in terms of creating a formal work, even if it is not formal in terms of its materiality, or holds that kind of a construct, and how the institution is also doing a very similar thing in reshaping its own form to work with this type of practice. I don't even really know how to ask any questions right now. I'm just so excited that this conversation is happening. I can't think of a single thing to say to ask that's pointed at the end, but maybe it just, my shaking with joy is enough, so thanks.
How It'll come you? To you soon.
Thanks to the Guggenheim for the courage to do this.
Yeah.
Yeah. Really? I have a comment based on what I thought was a question in there, but... But Lisa, do you have anything to say?
No, I was just going to say that I really meant it at the beginning of my talk when I said that, you know, Christina and Kim were really open to my ideas, which is not always the case in an institution. And I had a phone call with Christina and Kim first, and then Christina read an initial draft of the talk, and it was, Christina was actually like, put more personal anecdote, like, tell us your story. Honestly, that's never happened to me before. So, there's a lot of fear around the things that I say, things that have happened to me, how I am going to articulate them out in the world again, and I just felt very free to tell what I thought. So, thank you. Sorry. Go ahead. Sorry.
The only thing I want to say is that I think one of the risks that you're naming, I don't know where you went. Okay. Is that in potentially co-opting social practice, we lose some of its value, and that the institutionalization of this work will all of a sudden become something that can't be felt. And I battle with that all the time. And I think what's really important to continue to remember is that to support social practice, institutions need to trust the artist. And in order to trust the artist, oftentimes that means you gotta get out of the way.
So, I'm an art student, and I don't have as much experience as I feel like a lot of you guys. Very interesting to hear you guys talk. My quick question is, in your seemingly pretty long careers and experienced careers, have you seen the roles of maybe your current job titles change since when you started out as an artist, curator, director, and in what ways? Thank you.
If my job titles that I've had ever existed, I'm not aware of it. I mean, I don't think there was such a thing as artist services in the way that I did it at Creative Capital. Creative Capital started in 1999, and frankly, and I didn't get into it in this talk, but a lot of the work that I see social practice artists doing, in my memory, was happening in the education departments and museums.
Right.
And so, and when you might find this if you ever do an internship at an institution, they're more than likely gonna have you in the education department first, right? And so it has been interesting and fascinating for me to watch the ways in which that work has not been professionalized, but has been held up in a way that I'm happy about, but also feel sad about, because there were a lot of incredibly smart women, lots of women of color working in education departments, and lots of artists who were, I don't feel like were being held up as innovators or challenging the system or, but they were every day. It's just, it wasn't framed within a curatorial context or within a context that the marketing teams were talking about. So that has been a big change for me, rather than individual titles and things.
I know. I wish I had an answer. I mean, I will say one thing. Just,
oh, hello.
Hey, get up here.
Hey.
No, really, truly, because this work, talk about community work, talk about the intervention of people of color and bodies of color into museums, the entry point has not always been through the curatorial practice role.
That's right.
It has often been through the role of education, community engagement, public programs, et cetera, et cetera. And so you actually hit on something that no one wants to talk about.
Yeah.
The fact that...
That hence why I'm so excited they weren't afraid for me to be here.
No, but even now, when people are talking about social practice, there are artists that don't want to talk to education. They want to talk to curatorial only.
Interesting.
And so that's such an interesting point, but I just want to
say...
So
what I think I sort of touched on, which is a realization that there are actually a lot of artists who might have then engaged in some of the work, and their work is not easily accessible. We don't because it was temporal and the museums didn't collect it, and then they might have done it with the education department so they didn't get a catalog. So this has been a real difficulty when I meet people who are 20 years younger than me, and I assume they're aware of all of this work, but they're not because they can't find it in Google or in the library or, you know, any images of it, right? So once, by and large, I mean, both curatorial and education departments are resourced differently, but by and large, curatorial is where resources are put towards the documentation and archiving of these practices. So my belief is that the interest in moving into curatorial was to what happened, which is when I said artists want to be remembered. They want to be in the collection. They want to be revered in 20 years and get a retrospective, even though they weren't thought about 20 years ago, right? And it just, in the current structure, the way to do that is to work with the curatorial department and not the education department. In New York institutions, quite frankly, are very different. I had the experience of working in Columbus, Ohio at a collecting institution, and I often have this conversation with other people working in institutions outside of New York who are much further behind in terms of understanding how to work with living artists. So there is a lot, across the country, there is so much work to do. I mean, New York institutions are, frankly, way ahead of the game.
And I just want to say one thing without making this about the Guggenheim, but that we actually thought very carefully about this when we were formulating the social practice initiative here, and every one of the projects is co-curated by an upper-level member of education and a member of the curatorial department as an attempt to break down that boundary in a very specific way. It's just three projects amidst this whole thing, but it's I hope, something in terms of changing the discourse around how these departments are working.
Mm-hmm. And I just want to say, to connect the two comments, because I don't want to leave you hanging. I'm in a place now in my career where I'm trying to shed as many titles as possible, because I feel that artist is the single thing that is understood the most and the least that will get me into the room. It's that, again, going back to this nature of deception, which I think specifically where we stand now is the most powerful tool that artists can use. I will also say, however, that I fully think of myself as an educator. And so I will take on these titles when I feel necessary in order to have the right conversation. So if I need to be called one thing or another, whatever works. You know what I'm saying?
Go for it.
So I have more of a general question. In the discussion, Brett here mentioned how both reflection and action are important. Would you say that museums are shifting from places of commentary to places that act based on that commentary?
Places, you said, sorry, just to restate, places of commentary transitioning into places that are reacting to commentary? So, like, are museums becoming more react?
No, that act based on that, like, ideas that they represent. And interacting with society in that way.
Mm-hmm. So, the opposite of being reactionary.
Yeah.
Yes, I don't know.
I hope so. I'm not sure I quite understand, but you got it.
I do get it. I think many museums fall victim. Whenever there's a controversy, certainly, we see that museums are being reactionary because they've fucked up, and so they're not having the fuller, appropriate conversation. And in that way, yes, I think New York is ahead of the curve in many ways, but not all. I think it's a move, a hope, a desire, really, from the administrators within to generate the conversations that are necessary and be responsive rather than be reactionary. And there's a huge difference in that. And in order, but this is the thing. In order to be responsive and be relevant, you have to be in touch with the people that you're calling community. And for so many institutions, that still is Eurocentric, ticket-paying tourists. And so you can't be relevant and responsive if you're not really engaging in communities.
So I think for me, one thing I think a lot about is the idea of concession. And Jackie, you kind of hit the nail on the head when you're talking about how you're feisty. And it's really important to, like, you know, get what you want as an artist. Like, you're talking about Schloss Solitude. And I think about that a lot, being in academia and being in the art world. Where does one make their concessions? You're kind of talking about, you know, an institution you worked for previously, Shaun, like, and, you know, you didn't name it, but you're like, you could look it up. And there's a few other people that kind of mentioned that too. Where do we draw the line, and how do we know, like, where to push and what to push for? And then there's also the, like, oh, do people not want to work with someone who's too feisty? Are they going to be deemed too difficult to work with, or too difficult to work for? Also, you know, being a person of color and being, like, scared of an angry person of color. So, yeah, I guess that's a general question, but, like, have there been situations where you've had to navigate, you know, what do I push for and why do I push for that specifically?
I mean, every day of my life.
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
I mean, I can't, how do I want to answer this? I fully acknowledge that everything I do is in relationship to power and whiteness. And my stance, my strategy in life and in artistry has always to use a quote in Ralph Ellison's The Invisible Man, to keep my head in the mouth of the lion. And so what some people would call censorship or picking my battles, I call strategy.
Well, just that I think one tragedy is the fact that so many young artists are so in debt that they are being forced to have to participate in maybe an economy that they don't, or an institutional structure that they don't even want to, right? But it's impossible to continue to do your work without it. And, but, you know, what's interesting about that is I find that some of them are then potentially more savvy to understand power in a different way than, you know, a mid-career artist, right? Because they've had to be there, right?
Yeah. And art historians and curators.
You know?
Everybody, like, comes out of school with debt and then goes into a low-paying career. but there is definitely a differential between the people who are in institutional positions and those who are outside, just to clarify. I mean, the other thing about concessions is that, look, I mean, I think any position that you hold anywhere, whether it's in an art institution or in a corporation or anytime you're working in relation with others, there are going to be concessions, and there are going to be choices you have to make, and there are going to be people who are hard to navigate around, through, with, beside, and that's an ongoing daily struggle, and it could just be a personality clash or just a difference of opinion about how something ought to be done. And so that alone, just within any institutional structure, let's leave aside all of like the other issues of power. That alone is tricky because people are tricky, right?
But this is why, this is why I was trying to convey what Primitive Games meant to me. It really did reflect all of these emotions that I find myself having at work all the time.
Totally.
Right? Because for me, most often than not, I make assumptions about people because we're all in the arts or we're all interested in something, and then I come to find we are not on the same page about a lot of stuff. And so if we leave here with anything, I just feel like that Shaun's work can help us out in the world in that way.
Indeed.
Thank you. Okay, last question. So the pressure's on you. last question.
Thank you. I guess I'm just curious, I know that this is about like museum practices and like the museum institution, but with technology and the different ways that we've been creating different forms of access, do you guys think that you know, there will be a shift of artists kind of relying on institutions, on museums, as a main source of cultural preservation to different, you know, different forms like internet or different community ways of preserving art?
Definitely. Without question. And it's not only that, but different market mechanisms are going into play now too. I mean, if you look at the way galleries are starting to restructure and they're starting to use Instagram as like a sales tool and, you know, trying to like sort of short circuit the brick and mortar system of galleries and the art fair system, all of these things that are high capitalization at the front end. And so getting art more directly out to the world, giving artists therefore more freedom in distributing their own work and having direct connections with people through different kinds of different platforms, and that's gonna continue. And that's just one example. This is happening across the board with electronic journals, with all, you know, artists' own websites. I mean, that's going back decades at this point. And so the question of how that archive lives, I think, is maybe the longer term question. Mm. But these things are becoming increasingly systematized, and yeah.
So I am hopeful, but I think this is what I'm trying to reiterate in my talk, which is that I'm working at a place called Creative Capital. My assumption is that people are willing to think creatively about how to gain capital and do this. What I'm saying is that the museum still holds this lore for everyone that I want to understand better, but I don't, right? So, you know, we fund not just visual arts, we fund all the arts, particularly emerging fields, and we've had game designers and all kinds of people. If they get a call from a commercial gallery, maybe they're excited. If they get, someone wants to publish something, it's fine. If they get a call from a collecting institution, curatorial staff member, they're beyond excited.
Right.
I don't know what to say. I want to understand it, and I simply don't. Because I do agree with what Elizabeth is saying. There are all these other mechanisms. There are all these other ways that you can support yourself financially, creatively, have community. That sort of knighting of being in the large institution still exists, in my opinion.
I think of it as historicizing. Yeah. So it goes to the earlier points about, you know, the artists wanting to be remembered.
Yeah.
Well, I do want to shift some of the blame to artists here. Your question is a question of how and why artists want to become artists. And I think with the professionalization of grad school, artists are taught to this day, and it shocks me that the conversation is still about this is the way you're going to make it.
Yeah.
That limited conversation about this is the way that you're going to earn money and it has to be this singular path. And artists buy into it. I mean, we live in a capitalist society, so it's easier to buy in. And so if there's any lesson to be learned from social practice or socially engaged, whatever you call it, is that there's so much value in thinking of yourself as an artist in different ways. And if you can't get value out of the connection with community, and if you're only getting value from that sale, I don't know what you're in it for. I also will say, you know, that we have to... There were a lot of people at the performance last night, and it gave me such a sense of accomplishment. Mm-hmm. Way more people are going to witness my work online. Way more people. We need to, as an artist, I try to understand myself in that level of connection with people. And while it's distant, it's equally important, right?
I don't have to respond. That is something that I fear, you know, as an artist, like I fear having to rely on institutions to create the work that I want to create. And the work that I want to create, I want it to be accessible, you know, to, you know, not necessarily beyond the four white walls. And it's hard to know how to approach that.
Well, I think we have to start remembering that the things are not mutually exclusive. Right? Like, yes, I want to be in collections, sure. I also think that the way I'm going to be remembered is through the kids that I'm working with in the diversion program. And unless we start, as artists, defining ourselves in both of those modes, we won't steal power away from institutions. It's if we start valuing those conversations and the memory, the historical memory of us, in the minds of someone that just lives in the hood, that's where some of the work is, and that's where it needs to exist. If no one else hears about it, well.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Thank you.
Okay. Thanks. Thank you all.